Well, this is September 16, 2011, meeting of the Contractors and License Board come to order. I'm Bob Lamb, the new board chair, and I'd like to ask Joan Hancock, my secretary, to lead the Pledge of Allegiance.
Please stand.
Ready? Begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Tara, can you call the roll for me, please?
Bob Brown.
Here.
Dave Diaz.
Here.
Joan Hancock.
Here.
Pastor Herrera.
Here.
Matt Kelly.
Here.
Luis Kirkbride.
Here.
Bob Lamb.
Here.
Ed Lang.
Here.
Jim Miller.
Here.
Lisa Miller-Strunk.
Here.
Bruce Russ.
Here.
Paul Schifino.
Here.
Mark Thurman.
Here.
Oh, here.
Okay, John O'Rourke and Frank Shooter have excused absences this morning. Now, will the members of the board, senior staff, and members of the audience please introduce themselves? I'd like to advise the members of the public that identification by members of the public is voluntary. We'll start with our Director of Public Affairs.
Rick Lopes, Chief of Public Affairs.
Jim Miller, Board Member. Bob Brown, Board Member.
Karen Olinger, Chief of Licensing.
Dave Diaz, Board Member.
Ed Lang, Board Member.
Lisa Miller-Strunk, Board Member.
Cindy Christensen, Chief Deputy Registrar.
Joan Hancock, Board Member.
Bob Lamb, Board Member.
Steve Sands, Registrar.
Paul Schifino, Board Member.
Tara Maggi, Licensing.
Pastor Herrera, Board Member.
Matt Kelly, Board Member.
David Fogg, Chief of Enforcement.
Louise Kirkbride, Board Member.
Bruce Rust, Board Member.
Mark Thurman, Board Member.
Don Chang, Legal Counsel.
Do you start with the audience, please?
I'm Lisa Kemp,
I'm CSLB employee. Jeremy from CSLB.
Adrian Moran, Enforcement Supervisor, CSLB.
Jay Anderson, Enforcement Supervisor, San
Bernardino, CSLB. Denise Barnes, Enforcement Program Manager.
James Hina, Enforcement Representative 1 with Swift. Riley, Enforcement 1 with Swift.
Alan Smith, Pools, Speck, and Calcast.
Chris Acevedo, Enforcement
Rep 1. Frederick Chivari, Swift.
Sergio Alvarado, Enforcement Representative.
Jeffrey Flores, Supervisor Case Management. Dean Levine, Enforcement Rep Case Management.
Joe Upchurch, District Council 16.
Alex Beltran, District Council 16.
I'm Nicholas Reese, I'm a student at Mount Zach, and I'm a practice architecture.
Welcome.
Doug Robbins, DC 36. Bill Quisenberry, Agents and Allied Trades, Compliance.
Garcia, DC 36, Apprenticeship Coordinator.
Kent Gross Park, Appalachians, Gross Park, Brooklyn.
Michael Johnson, Saturday Public Interest Law.
Sam Tosh, Morgan, Enforcement Representative, Norwalk IC.
Gary McBorn, State of Norwalk IC.
Pastor Hardy, Enforcement Rep IC.
Maria Rodriguez, the LA.
Santa Lopez, Field Plumbing and Group.
Rosemary Hall, CSLB, Norwalk.
Sylvia Marina, First Representative.
Robert Nichols, D.
John Bond, Executive Producer. Program.
Oliver Biker, Executive Producer at 3M Weekend.
GOP,
Still from Monza.
Someone be Still from Monza.
Not the time to be watched, CSLB.
Okay, what are we not that up there?
Carlos Marquez and Swift.
Bill Morris of Norwalk Swift.
Serena Dorsey, Progressive Board of Norwalk
Swift. Gary Romiti, Norwalk Swift.
Maureen Crooks, CSLB, Norwalk.
Kevin Marcos, Norwalk.
Okay, I'd like to welcome you all, especially the students from Mount SAC. It's nice to see you all here and learn how a little bit of your state government works and how the funds are expended on your behalf. At this time, I'd like to take the opportunity to recognize and honor Enforcement Representative Ubaldo Sanchez. I think this is a surprise to Ubaldo. One of our investigators out of the Norwalk Investigative Center. I had the pleasure of meeting Ubaldo a little over a year ago when I attended a meet and greet with staff in the Norwalk office, And we just had another one of those, but I kind of like to call them down and dirty because it's just the board members and the staff, and it seems to actually produce some good results. Ebola demonstrated great enthusiasm and offered great suggestions on methods of improving day-to-day business. He felt ER should have a stronger, more professional presence when out in the field. Ubaldo showed initiative by taking a lead role in working with some of his peers to develop professional-looking business cards and metal ID badges. Ubaldo goes above and beyond and often volunteers to assist with community outreach events after hours and on weekends. He is willing to help whenever necessary, assisting his peers with difficult criminal cases, writing and issuing search warrants, and volunteering to train new employees. Ubaldo has successfully worked with SWIFT staff by participating in the HVAC undercover sting operation, which we were going to hear a little bit more about earlier, but we didn't get a chance. We got a little short on time. Ubaldo was recently instrumental in the success of the referral fee undercover sting operation. He attended the PHCC trade show at the Long Beach Convention Center and later posed as a plumber, coveralls and toolbox included. He called the water damage restoration companies wearing a recording device while asking for cash kickbacks. He ultimately referred 7 cases to administrative legal action. In March, when a judge suggested that Ubaldo perform surveillance on one of his respondents that had gone missing after posting bail on a $400,000 arrest warrant, Ubaldo wasted no time. After trying for some time to find the respondent, one day he saw the suspect leaving his house. He immediately called 911. The dispatcher told Ubaldo to follow the respondent closely and not to lose him. Well, and that's like telling a dog not to get off the meat truck. Ubaldo followed him until he went to a convenience store, a gas station, and eventually got on the freeway. While Ubaldo was following him, he could hear a helicopter overhead. The dispatcher instructed him to turn on his headlights, roll down his window, and wave to the helicopter. What a friendly group. After what seemed to last a lifetime, the respondent exited the freeway, and Ubaldo hot on his trail. Eventually, Ubaldo saw an LAPD patrol car go by. Dispatcher instructed Ubaldo to pull ahead safely in case the suspect was armed. Ubaldo witnessed the LAPD officers block off the streets, draw their weapons, instruct the respondent to lie flat on the ground, and finally apprehend him. Thanks to Ubaldo's persistence and heroism, the contractor is sitting in a jail cell today awaiting an October 5th court date. Ubaldo, it is my pleasure to be able to present you with a small token of our appreciation. And I'll have you come up here.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Let me read this. Ubaldo Sanchez, for your invaluable assistance in planning and conducting undercover sting operations to proactively enforce permit requirements and referral fee payment restrictions, you continually demonstrate a positive attitude and strong work ethic as evidenced by your willingness to assist coworkers with the execution of search warrants and assist public affairs staff with senior scam stoppers and other outreach events. The board appreciates your hard work, dedication, and commitment to consumer protection. Thank you, Ubaldo. Okay, now we have more surprises. Okay, the SWIFT unit is not to be left behind. Investigators Shane Messina and Dia Lee also deserve a recognition. Shane and Dai have been assigned to partner with the Los Angeles District Attorney's Office to combat the underground economy by targeting worker compensation violators. They have taken on this assignment with full force. To date, they have participated in 4 formal sweeps with the DA investigators, resulting in numerous citations for workers' comp and unlicensed activity violations. They demonstrate a strong work ethic and a willingness to take on assignments with a positive attitude. Daly is an excellent example of how hard work pays off. He has been able to promote through the CSLB ranks. Dai began his employment with CSLB as a CSR in the Intake and Mediation Center. He was promoted to Enforcement Representative 1 and provided invaluable assistance with the PIC Red case. Shane came to us from the Department of Corrections, where he worked as a classroom instructor. Being familiar with the behaviors and ways of criminal work has been very useful to Shane in his transition to working at CSLB. Not that, you know, he's working with criminals, it's that he works with criminals on the outs, you know what I mean. Okay. Both I and Shane have proven to be diligent in following up on lead referral assignments. From October 2010 through August 2011, Shane and Dye worked together and participated in 7 formal stings, resulting in a total of 85 notices to appear issued to unlicensed persons. From January through August 2011, Shane has scheduled, organized, and participated in 9 formal sweeps involving state agencies or the Los Angeles District Attorney's Office. Dye has scheduled, organized, and participated in 7. They both excel above the swift closure goals and statewide average. Dye has 201 closures, or an average of 17.5 per month, and 44 legal course, or an average of 3.6 per month. Shane had 258 closures, or an average of 221.5 per month, and 129 legal closures, or an average of 10.75 per month. There's no doubt that both Dye and Shane are valuable assets. And I'll go ahead and read these. I'm going to read their certificates as well on the microphone here. I forgot we were being taped today. Shane Messina, your hard work and dedication was instrumental in developing the successful partnership between CSLB and the Los Angeles County District Attorney's Office for criminal prosecution of underground economy violations. In addition, you have established highly effective communication with the construction industry, resulting in enhanced enforcement of contractors' state license law and workers' compensation insurance requirements. The board appreciates the excellent example you set, as well as your contributions to protect California's consumer and construction industry and legitimate businesses. That's for Shane. Dye Lee's certificate reads, your hard work and dedication was instrumental in developing the successful partnership between CSLB and the Los Angeles County District Attorney's Office for criminal prosecution of underground economy violations. In addition, you have established highly effective communication with the construction industry, resulting in enhanced enforcement of contractor state license law and workers' compensation insurance requirements. The board appreciates the excellent example you set, as well as your contributions to California's consumers, construction industry, and legitimate businesses. Dye and Shane, can I get you to come up and receive your awards? Okay, I would also like to commend Enforcement Supervisor Adriana Marin. She recently celebrated her 1-year anniversary as a supervisor over at the Norwalk IC. Adriana has done an excellent job in bringing the Norwalk IC together. Despite a heavy caseload, Adriana has shined in keeping up the morale of her staff. Her staff has rallied behind her, and they are taking her to lunch today to celebrate her anniversary. We're lucky to have her on board. Boy. See, you didn't know I was that surprising, did you?
Bob's buying.
I'll buy. I'm always good for at least a dinner or two. Okay, well, I think I've had enough remarks. Are there any other comments from board members they'd like to make at this time? Okay, at this time, we're going to open it to public comment. This item is provided for public comment pertaining to the items on the agenda as well as items not on the agenda. However, the board cannot take any action on items not listed on the agenda. The CSLB welcomes public comment on any item on the agenda, and it is the CSLB's intent to ask for public comment prior to the board taking action on any agenda item. But if for some reason we forget to ask for public comment on an agenda item, a member of the public desiring to comment on the item should raise their hand and they will be recognized. Also, we will be limiting public comment to 5 minutes per individual. Are there any individuals that wish to address the board at this time? Would you please take the podium and state your name for us, if you'd like?
Hey, my name's Alan Smith. I'm a contractor, Alan Smith Pool, been in business 30 years. Just want to let the board know, just recently, last Thursday, we had a meeting
He asked me to do a seminar for six newly appointed special agents just to go after workers' comp fraud in the county of Orange. So they specifically asked six agents, four of them for public works and two of them for private for now. The meeting turned into about 50. Dave Falk, Carlos, who were both there, EDD, Labor Commissioner, Insurance, Tony Torres, probably 20 other investigators, as long as insurance carriers and brokers, and amongst a bunch of other people. Orange County is actively going after workers' comp fraud because they see the detrimental effect it's doing to businesses in Orange County. Currently, I'm figuring probably 70% of my competitors in Orange County are non-compliant workers' comp and payroll tax. Those are figures that come out of our trade associations. So I encourage the board to embrace the outreach by the County of Orange that would like to work hand in hand with you and the other agencies. It was quite a productive meeting. And there was a recent article, not that recent, out of Cal Berkeley as far as the amount of workers' comp fraud and how it affects businesses. It was actually published in 2007. But it went back to mid-2000s, where it showed there's between $100 and $150 billion of underreported payroll in the state of California. That was before the recession. Since the recession, arguably, you can almost double that because of the amount of people that are dropping off. My motive to be there is survival, okay? I'm not gonna be in business much longer. Most of my competitors are 20% cheaper than me. So I've been working hand-in-hand with Dave and Carlos and several of the other enforcement agencies. I actually sponsored some legislation with several of the assembly members and senators at the state to get some proactive workers' comp reforms done that can help make your job easier. And so if you have any questions, maybe you can ask Dave some of the things we're doing. We have quite a few assembly members' ears to do whatever it takes to enhance your ability to do better and work with other agencies in interaction, communication. And the DAs are all willing to do it. Matter of fact, I'm going to be speaking at the California Association for District Attorneys about this whole issue and do a seminar to them about the scope of the underground economy and how it reaches all the different segments of our state, societies, you know, on and on, Social Security, workers' comp, fraud itself, and how it affects the employees, and on. So I just encourage you guys to embrace the outreach from the DAs. Any questions? I want to thank Dave for being so proactive on this. It's really been a big help. Dave Fogg.
Well, Dave was acting at the direction of the board. We've been very proactive on that issue for many years, and we are really, it's seeing coming to fruition here lately as more of the DAs understand what we've been able to accomplish in other places, and I think it's, you know, good news travels fast.
It is.
Like to help you.
And what they're trying to do is they're trying to enact the Business Profession Code 17200, which is the unfair business practice. If you have an unfair advantage over somebody else, they can actually go in and prosecute civilly and criminally. You guys get that information, you give it to them, they can act on it immediately at a different level than what you have with a lot more teeth. They're all willing, most of them are willing to do that if they have the resources. Orange County does, LA is going to do the same thing. I talked to Steve Cooley not too long ago, the DA for LA, and they want to maybe do 8 to 10 people. Great. So they really want to go after this, so just want to let you know.
Thank you. Are there any other members of the public who would like to comment at this time? Okay, hearing no further comments, we'll move on to item D, a review and approval of the June 7th, 2011 board meeting minutes. Do any board members have any comments regarding the minutes?
I move to approve the June 7th minutes.
Second.
Before we do that, I know that there's a addition.
There's a modification on the page 4, the licensing committee report, the motion regarding the blanket bond performance regulations. The motion should have read that the board was to give final approval of proposed regulatory changes to add California Code of Regulations, Sections 858 through 858.9, relating to blanket payment and performance bonds, and this is the part that was missing, and to give the registrar authority to make non-substantive changes as necessary. So that was the motion that was made. We just missed it in the minutes.
So I'll amend that to as amended, as Cindy points out, for the minutes to approve the June 7th board minutes.
Same for the second.
Second.
All right. Is there any discussion?
I only see two pages of the board minutes here. What's page four? Were you ready for that?
You must have got a defective packet.
Okay.
There's other packets in the back. I'd like to. Are there any other comments? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, we'll move on to item E, the Legislative Committee Report, status of 2011 legislation. Steve Sands will provide this report for us.
Okay, board members, you should have a status update sheet in front of you. This is the latest status of the board, the major legislation we've been following. It's a white sheet printing on both sides. Okay. Did everyone get one?
This one here?
This one here? Yeah. This one. Everyone with Paul since I took his. These are the bills that are on the governor's desk that have been signed. AB 275, AB 397, AB 878, AB 1091, AB 1307, AB 1424, SB 454, SB 541, SB 543, and SB 944. We suspect all of those will be signed. The ones that are asterisked are the ones that we sponsored. So he's got until October 9th, I believe, to sign or veto the bills. The only one we're kind of concerned about is SB 541. That's our subject matter expert contract provision bill, which the Department of General Services generally doesn't like anyone exempt from anything, but we've been doing it that way for the last 20 years, so we're hopeful their concerns will be addressed. But the department's supportive, and there's a lot of people supporting that bill. I think everything else will probably get signed. Any questions on any of these bills?
Steve, I had one real quick question on SB 886. Did they ever resolve the conflict between the California Building Code and the design and installation of sprinkler systems in residential homes?
No, that's a separate issue. This bill didn't address that, but that has not been resolved.
Thank you.
I actually did have one comment or question about 249. I think 249 is the legislation that amends the recovery for unlicensed activity by a contractor. And I think we have this as a watch.
Correct.
So at the end of the day, our dictate is to protect the consumer. And that creates a disparity between the commercial and residential work that contractors do, because as a commercial contractor, you generally don't work directly for consumers. You're working for big corporations. And what's happened with the law in the past is the way it dealt with the recovery for unlicensed activity is that, in particular in commercial work, and Don, I think you can chime in here at any point you see fit, that that due to administrative errors that occur at a contractor that's been in business for 20, 30, 40 years, administrative errors create a licensing problem where there may be a temporary lapse in the license. The way the law used to work, if there was a three-day lapse in your license, you forego all income on any project you were working on during that period of time, which for a commercial subcontractor, which I'm a C-51 licensed steel contractor, so near and dear to my heart, if there's a temporary lapse, it could put you out of business very quickly.
And there's some provisions in the code that provide for administrative lapses, but unfortunately, the court system has basically eviscerated that, so that a competitor of mine, I won't go named, ended up with a brother passed away who was a licensed qualifier. He did not get the 90-day notice, just for whatever reason, it missed his desk. So his license was suspended for a period of time, which he went and became the qualifier during this period of time. What I would consider to be a relatively unscrupulous general contractor who had a wonderfully built building that he sold to the owner and got paid full on, decided not to pay $750,000 to the subcontractor, and he had absolutely no recourse in the current law. The way it's drafted now is, with what they're proposing here, it gets rid of that inequity in the system. And I think right now, I think that we as a board, we should be supporting it, not on a watch list, because I think it balances the playing field by saying, look, if you're unlicensed for 3 days, you don't get paid for whatever you did during those 3 days, but we don't wipe out the entire contract. And so that's my position with it. Don, is that accurately reflect?
That's an accurate statement of both the existing law and also what this proposal would be.
So I think we should change it from a watch to a support. That's my position.
Just to clarify, we're not able to take that kind of position on this bill because of the notice requirements. I also might point out that the board was, I would say, pretty evenly split last time on this particular bill. Staff's recommendation was to watch because the bill is not going anywhere in its current draft, and we are working with the sponsors. My personal feeling is, although I would think the board is sympathetic to the situation for those lapses, since our consumer protection is our mandate, we feel it's the contractor's responsibility to make sure his or her license does meet the legal requirements. And if this thing was solvable, there would have been a solution. I don't see the solution that could pass the legislature. That's my personal opinion. We are working with the sponsors, but I just can't see this bill moving. Now, if the board wants to discuss this, we will be scheduling a legislative committee meeting in the fall, and that would be an appropriate time to revisit it. And hopefully we'll have some new amendments that we could have the committee look at. That's kind of the historical perspective on this particular issue, which just comes up every year in some format, some form. It's a real sticky wicket, it really is.
Is that acceptable, Paul?
I'll be the legislative agenda. Committee meeting.
Very good. Okay, are there any comments on the report Steve provided?
One more, revolving around SB 865, it is the indemnification of industry experts. I'm wondering, has this had any effect on our ability to attract industry experts to participate in the program at this point?
Well, I'll let David correct any misstatements I make, but no, this was more of a looking forward, would there be a problem in the future? There are two issues dealing with subject matter experts, industry experts. One was the contracting process, which we're much more concerned about, okay, which is SB 541, which hopefully will be ameliorated. And the other one was 865, which would, if there's a small claims court action against a licensee, which we don't think it's ever happened, would we protect them? So it was a pretty narrow issue that 865 dealt with, and it should not have any impact at all on our industry expert program.
Good.
Steve, I had a question on AB 1424, which basically amended that we would not have access to certain information from the Board of Equalization and Franchise Tax Board. And according to the analysis, we listed our position as a watch because we felt that we would have availability of that information anyway. So my question is, are you comfortable that the analysis on page 3 of 3?
Right.
Yeah. And it says the availability of the list could also assist CBLB. My question is, do you feel comfortable that we do have availability to that list, even though we're not included as part of the agencies that have access to that information?
We currently already have access to that information existing. What that law would have done, it would have expanded to other DCA agencies, but we already have the ability to basically suspend a license if the contractor has an outstanding liability for franchise tax or EDD or DIR. And we also, the previous bill before AB 1307 would expand us to also being able for, so that Board of Equalization could also have that same sort of remedy if they have an outstanding liability against a contractor.
I guess the question is, do we actually have that ability right now? I mean, do we have any problems accessing?
Yes, we do.
We have that ability. It was this was really meant for the other boards which don't have that remedy.
Yeah. This would have actually weakened our provision.
That's what I thought. But so, I just wanted to be sure.
That's why we didn't get exempted.
Yeah, you have the ability that you actually were able to access that information without any problem. Okay.
Are there any other questions? Hearing none, we'll move on to agenda item F, the licensing committee report. The licensing chair, David Diaz, and Karen Olinger will give us this report. Dave? Karen?
The licensing committee met on August 23rd, 2011, in Sacramento. The minutes of the meeting are in your packet. Some of the highlights for the meeting were, during public comment, Mr. Payton of Lakeside Plumbing provided information to the committee and expressed his concerns regarding disinfecting potable water lines. This matter was referred to staff for further review and possible recommendation to the committee at a future meeting. Chief of Licensing, Karen Olinger, provided the committee with licensee program update in addition to reporting on the application of workload statistics. Ms. Olinger updated the committee on the programming changes, forms creation process, and procedure development underway for the new limited liability company legislation that is to be implemented no later than January 1, 2011. It was reported that the new licensing fee schedule became effective July 1, 2011. A copy of the new fee schedule is in your packet under the program update. Ms. Olinger reported on the vacancies in the License Information Center, which is resulting in longer wait times for callers. She stated that the newly hired Information Center manager is working diligently to recruit for these vacancies and retain existing personnel. Karen provided the testing division update and announced the appointment of a new chief and testing division. Heidi Lincher Hill, former chief of testing Bob Porter, and manager Kathy Benner are now retired. Finally, Chief Olinger provided an update on solar alternative energy issues. She stated that as part of the licensing division, continued research on this issue, the CSLB asked NASCLA to survey all its state members as to how they are dealing with the classification overlap issue. She is awaiting additional feedback from the remaining NASCLA members. Enforcement Chief Dave Folk commented on his division focusing on many new solar alternative energy companies attempting to start up business in California to take advantage of California's solar initiative tax incentives without obtaining a contractor's license. The licensing committee will continue to address this issue in further meetings. This concludes the summary of the licensing committee meeting. I would ask for now a motion to approve the minutes.
I'd like to make a motion.
Oh,
I'd like to make a motion to approve the minutes.
Well, he just made it. I was wondering if I was going to ask for a second.
I'll second the motion.
Is there any discussion on the motion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Go to the licensing program update.
Licensing program update. Karen will now provide licensing and testing program updates.
Thank you. Okay, you'll find the licensing program update in your packet.
on page one of the program update is the application workload. As we continually report, the number of applications received continue to decline. You'll notice from the charts on the first page that the average number of original apps received per month in this last fiscal year is down 30% from the overall average of the previous 10 years. On page two are charts of the total number of applications received per month and the total number of applications received. The second chart, you'll notice a real drop in the month of July, and just to explain in case anyone was wondering what in the world happened, as you know, our new fees were implemented July 1st. A number of applications came in where they did not pay the appropriate fees, so they were returned. I think the cashiering unit had like a 44% increase in returning apps in the month of July. So that explains why all of a sudden, so no one panics and thinks the industry has come to a screeching halt, that's why it dropped to basically half of what we normally get. It's gone back up for the month of August, so it was just kind of a little blip in the system. Limited liability companies, as you know, the passage of SB 392 back in 2010 authorized the board to begin issuing licenses to limited liability companies. We had a one-year delay period in which to get this program implemented, basically because there's a lot of work that goes behind implementing a new program like this. Applications need to be developed, programming requirements, which crosses over to IT. But I can report we are certainly making progress on this. We have now developed the new bond that this bill requires, the $100,000 bond for the benefit of employees. We've had that bond approved by the Attorney General's office, and the Attorney General's office has filed it with the Office of Administrative Law. So that piece of the puzzle is done. We're working on the applications right now. We expect to have them over to legal counsel about the first week in October. So Don, clear your calendar. And then we're working with IT to develop all the programming. So at this point, we're confident that we're on track to have this implemented by the January 1st due date. I mentioned the fee increases on page four, shows the fee increases that went into effect July 1st. And with the exception of, as I mentioned, the applications coming in with the wrong amount, it seems to be going pretty smoothly. I think everyone's kind of got it down now. Licensing transaction processing times. See a little summary there at the bottom of page five, and then the charts that show the processing times are shown on pages 14 to 16. This is basically from the time that document, application, renewal, what have you, comes in the door, how long it takes for the staff to pull them for processing. And you'll see from the charts, for the most part, everything is being pulled rather quickly. The disposition report also is on page five. It just shows where in the system every application is that comes in, whether it's been issue voided or is still pending. Fingerprint criminal background unit. The charts at the bottom of page seven, since we implemented this program back in January of 2005, you can see we've received almost a quarter of a million responses back now from the Department of Justice. About 41,000 of those have had a criminal history hit, and we've denied just over 1,000. Half of those have appealed, and we've issued almost 1,100 probationary license. The Licensing Information Center, I'm sure all of our favorite topic all the time. They continue to struggle with staff vacancies. We did hire a new manager who started in June. His name is Jeff Tony. He's just doing an excellent job. His focus has really been to get these vacancies filled. He's filled three, but of course, as he filled those three people retired. So we're constantly struggling to hang on to what we have and get new people hired, but he is working very hard at filling those vacancies. We've submitted an exemption request, a freeze exemption request, so that we can open up, hopefully, the application process to more than just department internal candidates. He's also implemented some new kind of programs down in the call center, which I think have been just great and very helpful for staff. We have what it's called the quick tip of the day, that one of our analysts just answers routine questions or some of the more complex questions, sends it out to all the staff so everybody, you know, knows how to respond to these questions. He's putting together an enhanced version of our previous training, and we'll be sending all staff through the training process. So, yeah, like I said, our real battle right now is getting those positions filled. Once we get those filled, I think we're going to be sitting pretty good. The call wait times are on page 9, and they reflect pretty much just what I was saying about the vacancies. Then pages 10, 11, 12, and 13 shows the statistics of the judgment unit. The judgment unit is there to deal with all outstanding liabilities. Mr. Herr, you were asking if we already have the authority to suspend for example, franchise tax outstanding liability. We do, and we're doing it. And that chart on 11 includes those liabilities that have come from franchise tax, EDD, DIR. So it's, you know, it's a significant amount. You'll see in just this past July, we were instrumental in helping to collect over $1 million for the from those outstanding liabilities. Judgments on page 12, same type of thing. This is a contractor who has had a judgment placed against his or her license. If they don't clear that judgment within 90 days, we suspend the license, and you'll see, you know, we've got the numbers that we have notified, those that we've suspended, and how much money we were able to help collect as savings to the public. And then finally, payment of claims are the bond payment of claims. When a payout on the bond occurs, the contractor, again, has a period of time in order to clear that payout, otherwise the license is suspended. And again, we've shown, you know, the money that we were able to help collect. And then of course the total is on the bottom of page 13 of all outstanding liabilities, judgments, and payment of claims. And that covers licensing part, unless there's any questions.
Okay, I have a question. Uh-huh. What do you think happened with the fee debacle?
Well, we tried to get all the information out as far and wide as we could, but you know, at any given time, there are old applications still out there that people use, and it says the old fee on it. So when they sent it in, you know, either, yeah, they just had an old app lying around, or maybe they thought we wouldn't notice if they sent in the wrong fee. I don't know. If this routinely happens, anytime you change a fee, there's going to be a period of time before everybody gets up to speed, but hopefully that time has now passed. I haven't checked with cashiers to see, you know, what their reject rate is at this point, but in looking at the stats for August, we received, I think, about 900 applications, which is getting closer to what our normal amount would be.
Because we're in this period of transition, mm-hmm. are we going to be lenient if some of those people are found to, you know, their license is suspended or expired or something because of that glitch?
These are mostly for applications.
It's not our glitch. I understand it's not our glitch, but I'm just wondering.
They're mostly for applications, like for a new license or to add a class. So we send it back and we say, you know, send your app in with the new fee. So there's not, there really wouldn't be a period of time, like with a renewal, if you sent in the wrong fee and we reject it back, you could become expired. But there shouldn't be any question on the renewals. That is pre-printed on their renewal form, and we accounted for the fee change long before those forms ever went out. So they know what they need to pay on their renewal. Most of it, again, are the applications, and if you submit the wrong fee, you just get your app back and you send it back in.
Right. Thank you, Karen.
Sure.
there any other questions? Okay, if not, we'll head on to agenda item F3, testing division update. Karen,
okay. This will be quite brief. As mentioned, Bob Porter, the former chief of testing, retired over the summer, and so did Kathy Benner. Bob, of course, was the chief. Kathy was the supervisor. So Heidi Linser-Hill has now taken over as the chief of the testing division, and Wendy Balvance is now the supervisor of the exam development unit. The testing division update is also in your packet following the licensing program update. You can basically see what's been going on there. Most of the relocation and remodeling project is now complete in all the test centers, with the exception of Oxnard. Wait time is 3 weeks statewide at our testing centers, except for intermittent events such as the bar or engineering exams that temporarily reduce the availability at our testing centers. Exam development is shown on page 2. You'll see the current occupational analysis in process for the four classifications listed there, and then the new examinations that are in progress right now, meaning the occupation analysis is complete and they're now developing the actual exam, are shown in the other column for those classifications. The rest is just the update on the consumer satisfaction survey, which they're now doing online and sending to all complainants that they have the email address for. And they gave the enforcement representative one civil service examination at the CSLB test centers. This project was a partnership between DCA and the CSLB, and I believe they used the score system that we use for our testing our licensed candidates. And that's about it for testing, unless there's any questions.
I have a question. On the ongoing consumer satisfaction surveys, although I hear it's going into an annual report, I think as board members, it would be useful if we could sort of see it as it comes and not a year later. I know that's all going to be different because it's all coming in more immediately. Is there some kind of a report that gets generated that you guys see, that we could see on a more timely basis, or what?
I would have to check with Heidi on that.
There will be. But there was at least a one-year lag,
right. Yeah.
Just the way the system was set up, because we had to wait for the end of the year and then another year to compile it. So there'll be a way to, I think she said quarterly. So we're still, I don't know whether our staffing cutbacks have slowed that down or what. But yes, there will be a means to inform the board more frequently and more timely.
Thank you.
I remember that we discussed this at the strategic planning session. I think that was the quarterly would be something that we discussed.
Yeah. Are there any other questions? Hearing no other questions, we'll move to agenda item G, Public Affairs Committee report. Public Affairs Committee Chair Joan Hancock and Rick Lopes will give us the Public Affairs Committee report.
Good morning. Before I get started, I want to announce that we are very pleased to tell you that we are streaming live from Norwalk, California, and we want to thank our chief, Rick Lopes, for his persistence in making this happen. And also, we want to commend the Department of Consumer Affairs and thank them very much for making this a commercial-free live stream webcast. I want to introduce the other members of my committee, because we really function as a committee. And to my right is Bob Brown, and he's held the chair position for several years, as I recall, and also Ed Lang. And to my left is Pastor Herrera and Louise Kirkbride. Next, the committee is happy to report that our chief, Rick Lopes, traveled to Savannah, Georgia last month, and he attended the NASCLA meeting. And if you don't know, NASCLA is the National Association of Contractors, state contractors, agencies. And Rick was there talking to several state representatives such as himself about our programs and specifically about our disaster response program. And it was quite timely that he was there at this time because the very next day Hurricane Irene took over on the East Coast, and Rick brought it to my attention that the materials that he brought with him were distributed up and down the Eastern Seaboard, and so we're really anxious to hear back from you and find out how they felt about the added info that they got on your behalf. And I want to thank you, too, because I know you made this trip door-to-door, Sacramento, back to Sacramento in a 17-hour period, and you're really to be commended for your persistence. So thank you, Rick. Next, we are also very happy to announce that we, in Rick and his staff's pursuit of a reality TV show, for the last 2 years, we've been in pursuit of this, and it looks like we have an agreement with somebody that's sitting in our audience right now, and that is Jonathan Bogner, who is the president of Bogner Entertainment, is here also with his son Oliver. And Jonathan is also the executive director of Fremantle Media North America. And Fremantle, if you don't know the name, and you will at least recognize some of the shows that they sponsor, produce, I should say, and those shows are American Idol, America Has Talent, America's Got Talent, the new Simon Cowell presentation, X Factor, and there's a few others that I'd like to mention, the Ice Road Truckers, as well as The Deadliest Catch. And I also heard this morning from Mr. Bogner that he's produced 22 movies as well. So we are in great company, and we're interested in hearing from you, sir, or Oliver, your son, some ideas that you might have for a reality TV show for us.
Thank you to the board and guests. I'm Jonathan Bogner, executive producer for Fremantle, and as you said, Bogner Entertainment. And I'm going to introduce my son, Oliver Bogner, to kind of outline what we think we could do for the SWIFT program and the board.
Yeah. So my dad and I are father-son executive producing team over at Fremantle Media. And as you said, Fremantle is the production company behind American Idol, America's Got Talent. We also do Family Feud, Price is Right, and kind of our more manly shows include Storage Wars, which is now the number one show on A&E, Ice Road Truckers, Deadliest Catch, Axemen, and a whole bunch of other shows. And we, you know, we actually were researching kind of trying to find convict contractors, and we stumbled upon the SWIFT program, and we're like, this could be a reality show. So we, you know, we're trying to figure out how to kind of develop it and hopefully go out and pitch and sell it to a cable network. So the next steps are to, you know, meet with some of your team members, probably go out into one of your sting operations and kind of just observe and figure out who our cast of characters could be, because it really, you know, whether you watch Deadliest Catch or Ice Road Truckers, they really all revolve around these larger-than-life characters that we follow. So hopefully we can find some of those larger-than-life characters within some of your teams across California.
So we also want to thank Rick, because we've been working with Rick, and we're going to work with the law enforcement division. And we're going to cast a stellar group of characters.
We have one or two of those.
So kind of the next steps are, once we cast the group of characters, we'll then put together what we call a sizzle reel. So we'll go out with a camera crew to one of your sting operations with this group of characters that we cast, film them during the operation, get interviews and background on the program, and then go out to potential networks and pitch it to them, and hopefully they'll be interested. So, you know, in our experience, we really don't take out shows that we don't believe we can sell. So I think this could be a really fun show.
Wow. Yeah. Oliver sold a show this week, so.
We actually sold a show yesterday to True TV, so we're excited.
Wow. That is fantastic.
Yeah.
So we think there's a lot of opportunity here for us, and so it's all about, as Oliver said, it's all about the characters and the organization as such. So thank you guys very much. If anyone
has any
wants
questions.
To ask any questions.
Well, I know that you could film our board meetings because they're very exciting, action-packed, and always a lot of fun. Yeah. So you're always welcome here.
I thought that was like C-SPAN.
Well, we try not to make it that good.
Cool. Well, thank you guys very much.
Thank you. And I also want to thank Rick once again, because I don't think they would have found us if it hadn't have been for public affairs and just all the hard work. And not that it's a one-person job. We know you have a lot of support, so thanks again. The next issue that the committee would like to bring before you is that Public Affairs is actually going through some trainings at this time to assist the IT division, because the IT division was hit very hard by the hiring freeze. So staff in Public Affairs has stepped up, and they're actually doing this training so they can learn how to work with IT and actually post their own press releases and industry bulletins, I understand, and also the scheduling of the Senior Scam Stopper events. So we want to thank your staff as well for us for making that effort, and also IT for letting them come in and doing the job with them.
Yeah, I think they're all back in Sacramento watching right now, so they hear you loud and clear.
Hey, guys. Okay, and that brings us to the CSLB Wellness Program, which as I remember, it's on page 6 of your pack or 7 of your packet. Well, the Wellness Program is something that takes place at headquarters, and this year it's going to be November 2nd, and there's events that go on all day. I think there's 20 different booths, and we're encouraging all the board members to attend, and or as many of you as can attend. And looks like it's a fun time. It's an informative time, and there's all kinds of things. Steve's going to lead us in an exercise program, and I'll lead the eating program. We also want to thank, I don't know if you're here, Doris Velasquez. Are you here? And if so, stand up. But if you're not here, just commend Doris for instituting the same kind of program in the Norwalk office here. And that takes us to agenda item G1, which is the review and approval of the August 23rd, 2011 Public Affairs Committee Summary Report. The Public Affairs Committee met on August 23rd in Sacramento, and the summary of that meeting is in your packet. Notable in the meeting was the review of a recently completed advertising campaign, including post-campaign research. I think Rick is going to talk a little bit more about that. The committee also got an update on public affairs action items in the 2011-2012 strategic plan. And unless there's any questions from the board, I would request a motion to approve the August 23rd committee summary report.
So moved.
Second. There's a motion and a second to approve the committee's report. On the question?
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed. You do that so well.
Thank you. We make a good team.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Okay, we'll go ahead and move on to...
We have...
You have another one?
Well, no. I think we're going to move to agenda item G2 so that Rick, our chief, can give the program update for public affairs.
Thank you. The first thing I wanted to note for the on the board's behalf regarding the reality shows, we did actually, you may remember that we did have a previous contract with a company that spent the better part of a year trying to you know, pitch a show with no, well, very little success. So we're really excited. We actually had three different production companies that came to us. It was nothing that we did going out and searching. They came across our information and came to us. And of those three, we chose to work with Jonathan and Oliver. So we're very excited about the prospects of this and moving forward. As far as the ad campaign, as we did cover in a lot of depth during our public affairs committee, is the campaign and our three-year contract has now ended. At this point, we have not entered a new contract. We've run into some legal problems on actually having an advertising contract through the Department of General Services. So we're looking at opportunities for individual projects that we can do throughout this year to use the money that we've been budgeted. But per se, this year, there's not going to be a paid advertising contract. As I begin to the public affairs program update on page one, I just wanted to note in the staffing update, we did note there that one of our positions, one of our information officer positions, has been open for a number of months due to the hiring freeze. We've had a few candidates, but we were not able to fill that position. I just wanted the board to know now that position has been eliminated, so it's not going to be a position that we're going to be able to fill. As far as the website highlights, you notice at the bottom of page one is our likes and followers on Facebook and Twitter continues to grow. And again, we did some promotion as well on that for the live web stream today. On page two, in our email alert feature, the number of people signing up has continued to grow. We are always looking for ways, as we state in every meeting, is to get people in the industry to sign up, because we have well over 300,000 licensees, and we've only got, you know, less than 5,000 people signed up to receive this email alert. We have another roughly 80,000 people who we've gathered email addresses from their applications, but that leaves us with a couple hundred thousand people that we don't have email contacts with and no way to reach them on either an email basis or to let them know when we have a newsletter that's available. So anything the industry can do or ideas of things that we can do, please, we're all ears on how we can try to get that list to grow even more. On page three, I'll just note on the press releases at the bottom of page three and goes on to page four, and at the end of the Public Affairs Committee program update, you'll notice there's a media packet of some of the media coverage we've received over the last couple of months. On page four, the disaster outreach highlights. Luckily, the disasters lately have been on the East Coast, and as Joan mentioned, the timing was good. We were actually not sure for a while we'd be able to head back to Savannah, because Hurricane Irene actually was, that's where they expected landfall to be, but as the week progressed, it took a turn to the right to the Carolinas, so we were able to do that, and we were able to give gave the presentation, and it was well received, and they appreciated the fact that we did have items available. We even had stuff available before Irene to them, and then networking with NASCLA, they made sure that all the other states, regardless or not, if they have contracting boards, because some states don't actually even regulate the construction industry, we made sure that the most appropriate people were made known that this information was available to them. So hopefully we'll be able to check back with NASCA that they've been able to follow up to find out. But at least the information was available and they seemed very receptive to it. We don't know how much it'll be used because it was very specific to California law, even though there's lots of great tips. I also did want to note for the board that our central SWIFT unit has been involved. We had a wildfire over the last week in the Tehachapi area near Bakersfield, and we know that there were 32 homes that were destroyed. At this point, they have not determined CalEMA, which is the emergency office from the governor's office. They've not determined if there's going to be any local assistance centers. If there is, we will have staff there. But our staff has already been involved with the sheriff's department in Kern County, as well as the district attorney's office. They've begun their educational outreach, including using our materials to do outreach to the 32 families who've lost their home in Tehachapi. We did have a new contractors bulletin that went out late last month. It's available on our website. There is a link off the homepage as well. Moving on to page five, you see the new design of business cards for our staff and the ID cards. We are also in the process of finalizing new ID cards for our sworn peace officers, so that will be coming very soon. You see on page five as well, at the bottom are publications showing the list of the things that have been updated. We'll talk a little bit about that in the strategic plan, because we do have publications as one of our main goals over the next year. Moving to page six is the senior scam stoppers. The list that you have there has been updated. For the board members, you'll note that we left a piece of paper there where you're sitting. For the folks in the audience or watching online, we'd encourage you to go to our website on our homepage. There is a link to senior scam stoppers. We have an updated calendar of events that we're doing around the state, and we would encourage board members to join us for that. I know that the pastor joined us for a Scam Stopper last Saturday in West Covina, not too far from here, and thank you for that. We would encourage any participation from board members to join us on those.
Can I make a comment on that? It was a really great experience. Even though the participation was small, but I think we had a really good discussion with those that were there. The representatives, other than contractors, was the Department of Insurance, Department of Real Estate, and also the Public Utilities Commission. And I kind of provided some background on consumer fraud in general. But it was really, really, the community really benefited from that discussion, I think, from the service. The location was excellent. It was a senior center that's new. Really, really a nice place. And I think the community in general really enjoyed having these state agencies there presenting to them issues that impact their lives, particularly financial lives. And congratulations to you and your staff for putting that together.
I just want to comment on that. The ones that I've been to, you know, I've been to some that were had a smaller turnout than that, and the other one a larger one. And the other reason that we do this really is to network with those legislators and local area government officials, because really it's also them that are networking on our behalf, and they're getting the message out, and these are their constituents and the people in their districts, and they care about those people, and they come from both sides of the aisle. And so it isn't just, although that is our main concern, is the seniors and when we do these Scam Stoppers, but it's also to have this opportunity to network. And thanks for going, and I look forward to doing one myself.
Thanks. And one of the things we're looking forward to, I don't want to get too specific on part of this, but what we're trying to do too is we're going to be doing next month is we're going to be tying in one of our outreach events to a sting operation. So there's going to be a sting operation going on in a predominantly senior area here in Southern California, and then a couple weeks later we're going to actually be doing a senior Scam Stopper. So we're going to be trying to doing more than just kind of going out hitting them with a couple different ways, and we'll attempt to have media cover the sting operation itself. So this is a fairly large senior community here, and so that's one of the things we're working with enforcement in the next month.
Mr. Chairman, if I could ask Rick a question.
I'm sorry?
Under your senior Scam Stoppers on your general outreach, IAPMO, IAPMO,
October
International
8th.
Association of Property Management Organization.
October 8th.
I don't know.
Yes.
Do we know what it means?
Oh, you know, I'm going to ask Carlos, who's actually speaking to that. He's been maybe in touch. Carlos, might you know what I've got my person, Jane Kreidler, who deals with that, has been the point person on dealing with the agency. Do you happen to know what on October the 18th, Carlos, you're going to be in Commerce doing a lunch meeting of IAPMO?
Oh. It may be the International Association of Plumbing and Mechanical Officials.
That's
what it is. Okay. Ask a plumber. That's it. Ask a plumber if you want to know.
Okay. There you go.
I just actually wanted to add too, just in Columbus, Northern California. Hopefully, we can get some of these.
We absolutely plan to. It just some of the things. It's worked out where we've gotten the calls back, or they've been a little bit faster on. But definitely, we will not ignore Northern California. Okay, on page 7 is the employee wellness. Joan did note a little bit about it. We do have our wellness fair going on at our headquarters on November the 2nd, which is always really well received. And as you can see, actually, at the bottom of that page, we did an online survey of our employees in Sacramento, asking them about their participation in the wellness program and the kinds of things that they would like to see us doing. And you can see their responses there. But the wellness fair is going on. We also, as Joan mentioned, Doris here in Norwalk is really helped spearhead, and we've got a lot of folks here in Norwalk that have, you know, participating in our wellness program. Normally not something you see out of a public affairs office, but we've, you know, taken up those duties. Luckily, we've got a retired annuitant in Sacramento who has kind of spearheaded that. It's been a passion of hers, so we were able to do this and provide this, and we've gotten a lot of good feedback from our employees. And unless there's any questions, that concludes the public affairs report.
Are there any questions?
Rick, just one quick comment.
comment. In the past, you put the news articles in a stuck packet,
yes.
And I've kept that at my front counter because people tend to read those while they're waiting for us to wait on them. And it might be just a thought, if you want to get those out to local building departments to get, maybe a shorter version of this and just make it reading material on our front counters.
Terrific. We can do that.
Mr. Chair, I think that concludes the Public Affairs Committee report.
Great. No, are there any further questions? Hearing no further questions, we'll move to agenda item H, Enforcement Committee Report. And the Enforcement Chair, Matt Kelly, and David Folt, Chief of Enforcement, will give this report.
Okay. We will open up the Enforcement Committee Report and mention that we had a board meeting on August 23rd in Sacramento. I appreciate all the board members that were in attendance at that meeting. At that meeting, we had the pleasure of swearing in a new peace officer for the CSLB, Joseph Martinez. And Joseph came to the CSLB about a year ago, and prior to that, he had been a Stockton police officer, laid off and then found a home with CSLB. So that is good news. In addition, there was a training update. There were training modules on stop orders, conflict resolution, hearing officer, team building, criminal investigation and filing of criminal investigations, criminal investigation procedures provided by the Riverside District Attorney. And we'd like to recognize Doug Galbraith. We heard it again in a meeting that we were involved with this morning over at the Norwalk office. We were told that don't let that guy go. He is an excellent asset to the CSLB. And Doug comes to us as a retired CHP officer, retired as a captain with 30 years with the CHP. He has a certification as a law enforcement trainer and has extensive experience teaching investigative techniques and evidence requirements to support penal code violations. So again, I know we recognize Doug at our committee meeting, and certainly recognizing him today as well, and the staff that are present could probably testify to how effective he is as a trainer.
They actually did this morning. They all sang his praises, and we'll make sure he gets that message.
And as I'm sure you've all seen in your packet, new proactive enforcement initiatives. Certainly, staff's diligent. This was part of our strategic plan in 2011-2012. And staff has worked tirelessly in ensuring this. Certainly, this is part of the PAC effort. And to see them working with other industries, the top four construction industries that were impacted by the underground economy were identified as the HVAC, roofing, landscaping, pool construction. And working with them, they have partnered with state and local government to track tax withholding, business licenses, permits, illegal advertisements, and consumer complaints. The pilot cities included Pleasanton, California, Chico, Fresno, and Burbank. They established baseline statistics and performance metrics and mounted an educational campaign where they performed targeted enforcement, and they measured their successes through enforcement actions and return on investment. So that's an excellent program. We're very pleased to see that it's working well. I believe it's happening throughout the state, and it is one more effort in our parts to battle the underground economy through the license board's enforcement division. We do have a necessity for a motion to approve the enforcement committee meeting summary report, and I would entertain that motion if anybody came up with it.
I so move.
Second.
Okay, we've got a motion to accept the summary report. We've got a second. Are there any questions on the motion? Seeing no questions on the motion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. All right, then, an enforcement program update from Mr. Dave Pope will complete our discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. If we could turn to page one under agenda item H2, just wanted to share a couple of highlights that relate to our intake mediation centers. The first one addresses a pregnant woman that hired someone to remove the acoustical ceiling, not realizing it was a pre-1978 home and that the acoustic included asbestos. When she discovered that, a complaint was filed. Our consumer service representative was able to negotiate a settlement whereby she received $12,000 from the contractor so she could hire someone that's properly certified. Unfortunately, this contractor believed, because he had filled out the application with the CSLB, it gave him the ability to remove that type of work, which it did not. I'd like to compliment the public affairs staff and the information that's available on the website that makes it very clear, if you're going to be removing acoustic or material that includes asbestos, then you need to register, you need to be tested by the Department of Industrial Relations. At the bottom of the page, we have what we really consider to be a fairly common type of case that we handle, where someone files a complaint alleging poor workmanship. We talked earlier in the legislative update about how vital the industry expert program is. This is a good example of this, because we have industry professionals that are willing to assist us in resolving our disputes. Many times they have to go out to the job site, but other times we can pick up the phone and let them know what we're dealing with. In this case, we have a concrete project that was paid, $43,902 was paid towards it. The consumer was unhappy with the finish. And based upon the information we received, we were able to help negotiate a settlement whereby the consumer received a refund of $4,800, and we were able to close the case. It's a win-win for everyone. The contractor avoided further investigation, possible civil action. Case was settled. And it factors in to our overall goal of helping to resolve these licensee complaints that don't contain an egregious act. If you look at the top of page one, we're very proud of the statistics that we've included. July 1st to the end of August, the Intake Mediation Center were able to recover over $9 million in restitution to consumers, either by compelling a contractor to return and perform work or to pay restitution. That's slightly ahead of the last fiscal year. So, any staff here from the IM, we want to thank you all for the hard work you've done to make that possible. At the bottom of page two, we have a highlight relating to a subcontractor that was not paid. Prior to this meeting, I surveyed staff to see if we were receiving an increase in what we consider to be a misuse of fund case, and that a prime contractor received payment and did not use that payment to pay a subcontractor who performed the work. We're not necessarily, the feedback I received is that we're not seeing a measurable increase. However, we are still receiving complaints, and we're very pleased with this one, that we're able to assist the subcontractor in recovering over $80,000 in unpaid money. On page three, we have a highlight that relates to our partnership with the California Department of Insurance. Many of you are aware that we work very closely with the Department of Insurance, and we're more than willing to help them on this investigation, which related to fraud in insurance and mortgage fraud. And we have the leader that ran this task force with us today, Jim Anderson. So Jim, put your hand up. Really stepped in. They had served a search warrant. They'd uncovered a lot of evidence. But in order to strengthen their case, they needed to have additional evidence that related to the financial injury. And what that requires is that we use our industry expert program to go out and look at the value of the work that was performed. And under Jim's leadership with the staff in San Bernardino, they were able to obtain that information within 3 weeks, which is very beneficial to their efforts. What was a little disturbing, though, if you take a look at the highlight, is that initially the three principals were held on $1 million bail each, but it was subsequently reduced to no bail, and they were released on their own recognizance. And I was kind of disappointed to see that. But what Jim explained to me is they're not necessarily a flight risk. They don't consider it to be a serious felony. And it's something that we're going to be faced with at the CSLB Enforcement Division, is the overcrowding in the prison system, and to a certain extent at the county level.
They now have this, I don't know the exact terms, Jim explained it to me, but it's a prison transfer program where they're trying to keep people out of state prison. They're wanting to put them in the county jail. And you know, one thing I want to really emphasize today is looking at different ways to handle these type of cases. And what really strikes me is that they've made a lot of money through this illegal activity. I mean, if you turn to page four, what you'll see on the second paragraph is that the Velasquez case, or contract, I should say, where they took a contract and they received $180,000, yet they performed no work. Where is all that money? Well, we've had a search warrant served. Perhaps this is a case that we could look towards an unfair business practice with. Something I want to talk to the Department of Insurance about and see if this is possible. Because then, as we were able to determine through our service and repair investigation in which we were able to recover $3 million for injured consumers and for our costs, if you have evidence of ongoing illegal activity, that can be recovered at $2,500 per violation. Mr. Smith noted the Orange County DA is on board with this, Los Angeles DA is on board with this. We need to look for cases where we can impose that type of sanction so that someone's committing a crime, harming people, that they use their money to not only reimburse the consumers, but also to pay for the investigative and the prosecution costs. So this might be a possibility. On the bottom of page four, we have mycontractor.com. Another interesting case that you know furthers the argument to looking for perhaps an unfair business practice. With this complaint, we were able to establish that the contractor had received $31,900, did not perform any work. There were a number of, there were, of course, resulting felony charges that were filed. However, on August the 23rd, he walked into court and he showed the judge a cashier's check for that amount of money. And in doing that, he was able to get the felony charges reduced to misdemeanors. And it would appear, as I learned yesterday, that he's likely only going to do one day in the county jail. So we definitely want to keep our eye on that contractor because in a second we're going to talk about someone that really proves the adage that most of these, what we call, you know, certainly unscrupulous contractors will continue to reoffend. On the bottom of page five, we have a highlight relating to an owner-builder that was constructing a home without use of licensed contractors or a licensed general contractor and, quite frankly, doing a very poor job of it. It's something we've heard routinely from building officials that we need to do more about. They've complained that the owner builders are going, they're getting permits, they're not using qualified people to perform the construction. It creates a real problem. So we included this highlight to show that we're focusing more on that type of activity and we're issuing citations when they're unlicensed contractors. Now, just something else that's not a highlight in the packet, but I just wanted to share with you is the stings that were conducted this week primarily by investigative center staff, and they relate to heating and air conditioning contractors that have been identified as performing work without getting a permit. So they're performing the heating and air conditioning unit changeouts without getting a permit because they don't want to hire a raider to come in and pressure test the ductwork. Well, what we did is we warned these contractors, we identified those who are doing a lot of work, and then we called them out and we asked them to bid the job and asked if a permit was needed. The results that we've received are quite varied. In San Diego, we called three of them out and all three said a permit was no longer needed. One of our investigators, I believe we have an investigator here today that was the lead on the Burbank undercover operation, she called 12. 10 of them said we can no longer work without a building permit. So that was a success. We're going to need to look at all this data that we've received and see what's the difference. Why is the difference between San Diego, Burbank, and then in Fresno, 67% you didn't need a permit, but in Pleasanton, I understand only one person said they could still work without a permit. But it really is furthering our partnership with the building officials and trying to figure out a way to gain additional compliance, and perhaps we could do work with public affairs to put out press releases to educate others. On page seven, moving to the SWIFT update, many of you were at the Enforcement Committee meeting on August the 23rd, so you are aware of Mr. Mafia. A little background on him, he's quite a colorful gentleman, and that maybe 3 or 4 years ago, he had opened an office, he opened a shop that was a few blocks from CSLB headquarters, and he was doing cabinet work at that time, as I recall. But he didn't always deliver the cabinets. You know, he would take the money and he would deliver. And you know, unfortunately, he did 4 years in state prison, and he got out, and now he calls himself Wolf Excavating. And we started receiving complaints, mainly from employees, but also from other contractors, and, or someone that, had, I should say, someone that contracted with him and he didn't perform well. So we were able to get a warrant for his arrest, and he came in on the 23rd to see about getting a contractor's license. So he wasn't successful in obtaining a license, but he was successful in a free ride to the county jail. So he's just someone that really needs to look towards another line of work. And just to kind of wrap up the SWIFT update, we are faced with challenges working with local prosecutors and local law enforcement. They have budget restrictions. Often they don't have a peace officer available to back up our staff at stings. As you're all aware, our peace officers are not armed, so we do request that we have, on average, two armed peace officers participate with us. We need to look for opportunities to address workers' comp violations, because if we can do that in conducting a sting, then the Department of Insurance would like to partner with us, but also DA investigators. We had great success a couple weeks ago in Clovis in identifying contractors that had employees, confirming that we made the bid, encouraging them to bring their employees to the job site. And many of you get Steve's weekly report, and you would have read that we issued 9 stop orders. So the stop orders continue to be a very effective tool. Well, what I wanted to share with you, though, is that one of those individuals that was issued a stop order appealed it. We've issued over 80 stop orders to date, and we've had 2 that have been appealed. One, of course, was a licensee that subsequently proved that they had workers' comp, and we released the stop order. But the gentleman that appealed it from the last sting requested a hearing. He put on his appeal that the 2 guys that were with him were actually partners. So he was going to come into the hearing and show that he had a partnership agreement. Now, he had received a notice to appear for being an unlicensed contractor. Had he come to the hearing with this document, they would have all received a notice to appear in criminal court. So what likely happened is he talked to somebody and they said, that's not the best idea. Probably don't want to do that. So when he showed up at the hearing, he acknowledged that they were employees. In fact, you know, he acknowledged that he'd had more than just the 2 employees, so the stop order was upheld. But it is proving to be a very effective tool. The licensees are getting a policy almost immediately. And the unlicensed contractors, some of them are now coming back as an employee of the owner, which is troubling, but many of them are hopefully getting a license. We're not tracking that data, but we are not finding them back on the job site, which is positive. And just the last thing for SWIFT, the Economic Employment Enforcement Coalition is going through a transition. It's likely going to be reconstructed as the Labor Enforcement Task Force. There won't be so much of a sweep environment. It's going to be more focused on targeting industry leads. So you have a problem contractor, that would be the contractor we'd focus on, instead of just going out and doing more of the random sweep. So I'll keep you all posted on with that. I'm looking forward to having a meeting soon with Christine Baker, the Acting Director of Department of Industrial Relations. On page 10, we have the complaint handling statistics. The enforcement staff continues to exceed the board goals as it relates to the production, to the settlement of cases, and the cycle times. To thank the Norwalk staff that's here, they've done a fantastic job in getting the case age down. When we prepared this report, we had 77 cases over 9 months in age, which is just about our all-time low. So thank you all for your hard work. On page 11, just a quick public works update. Now, this program continues to, I think, to do well. We have 2 investigators assigned to it, 1 in Norwalk and 1 in the Bay Area. Had a lot of work with David Diaz and his group in trying to identify problem contractors. Just a couple things I'd share, though, with the board members in the audience is what we're finding is that you tend to have the prime contractor is licensed and they have workers' comp, and they're listing their subcontractors when they're submitting the bid. And some of those subs are not performing. But what's real troubling is that the second-tier contractors, you have a sub now that is subbing out to someone that is not licensed. And some of these subcontracts are in the $1 million range. It's absolutely incredible. So we want to make sure the citations fit the crime. I think if you read Steve's last report, you know that B Electric, the solar contractor that we found doing $87 million worth of work, you know, we hit them with maximum penalties, and they came in with their checks totaling $45,000. But we have some more coming down. They're going to be referred to the Norwalk case management for legal actions against contractors that are second-tier contractors that we've identified. They're doing million-dollar contracts. Many of them don't have any, they don't have workers' comp. But the way the law is today, if we can establish the unlicensed contracting activity, we can take action on that. But if we can't, there's no grounds for a disciplinary action against that second-tier contractor. And just one other thing that's become quite evident is we have residential contractors that have been revoked, and now they're out in the public works arena, only they're not listed on the license records. You know, they're behind the scenes, they're on the corporate records often, but they're not on our license records, so we're having to conduct targeted stings to address these people. What we're doing is setting up stings, and I'd like to compliment the IBEW for giving us a sting site to accomplish this goal, bringing them out, and when they come to the job site, they're revoked, they're restricted from that type of activity. That's a mandatory 90 days in jail. So you can look forward to future updates on our success in addressing that problem. I'd be happy to entertain any questions you may have, because that concludes my update.
Are there any questions, David? Hearing no questions, we'll move on to agenda item I, executive committee report. Administrative and Information Technology update. Cindy Christian will provide this update. Cindy?
Thank you. On page one of the executive report, you'll see the administrative program update, and the first thing you'll see is a table of upcoming examinations and the status. One thing that we have been doing with all of the vacancies, currently we have 65 vacancies, and that continues to climb with retirements and people transferring to other agencies or within the department. So we're kind of in a bind there, but what we have been doing is we do advertise the positions with a disclaimer in there that says that, you know, we're anticipating that we may get some exemptions approved or that the freeze may lift somehow. So we are trying to get people from the outside to apply, and we're going to interview them. The major areas that are impacted, of course, are enforcement and licensing. So we are getting, we have all the exemptions forward for almost all vacancies in enforcement, correct, David?
That's correct.
And in licensing, we submitted exemptions for the call center. And then, of course, in information technology, we've submitted exemptions there. They are getting stopped at the Department of Finance, however, because they're just so overwhelmed with their workload. It just kind of seems to bottleneck there. So hopefully we'll get some type of a modified hiring freeze exemption process where maybe Department of Finance will be removed from that approval process. But for right now, that's what we're dealing with. On page two, there's another table just showing you the breakdown of where our vacancies are. And then we have the business services update that gives you our spacing, leasing, and facilities progress report. Really nothing new going on there, just a continuation of remodels. And then in Bakersfield, we are trying to get a new location. The contracts in process, I just want to highlight the our classification study projects in our enforcement unit. That contract should be approved by today. It was at General Services, and that's for the Cooperative Personnel Services to come in and study getting chief deputies under David, two of them, one in Northern, one in Southern California, looking at the pay disparity and classification of our enforcement rep and enforcement supervisor series, and then also looking at reclassifying our consumer representative series to a staff service analyst series. Moving on to page three, you'll see the fleet. We found out today that we have put in an order for 15 vehicles, and we're hoping that the new process of rotating vehicles will assist in our getting those, at least some of those vehicles approved, because our fleet does continue to age, and I noticed that there was one car in the shop, so they just get up there in mileage. And we've also completed the employee badging and identification cards. We did get new cards issued to almost all employees at this point in time. Any questions on this? Moving ahead to the IT update, the limited liability company project, they're pretty much on track for that. Nothing really new to report there. They've just been working with licensing and getting the programming changes in place so that we can meet our deadline of January 2012. Our website continues to be a problem. We've been hit by these malicious bots where they've been
it's like a software program where it comes in and it just keeps scraping data constantly, and we've just, we got hit really bad where our server crashed and it was really slow for a while. So our IT division, Amy and Jason, have been working with the Office of Information Technology to get a fix in there. And at first they were saying it wasn't a malicious attack, so they weren't really going to do anything. Amy's a fighter. She went in and said, no, it is malicious. You need to do something. They've put in a temporary type of a fix. We still get some hits. It's not quite as bad, because what they were doing is we'd block the IP address that these hits were coming through. Well, what they would do is just create a new IP address, and they'd come back in and get us again. So at this point, what they do have a temporary fix. We do have one individual that just kind of screens it to see if, you know, somebody's gotten in somehow. And we're working to get a piece of hardware that they can install at the mainframe so that it can just prevent this from here on out. So that's what they've been working on, and I really have to commend our staff because they really know what they're talking about.
Is it just people mining for, like, marketing?
It appears to be. We had one individual, Amy was on the phone with him because he was very upset because the day we started blocking it, he'd just bought the software to get our data. So we've had a couple of those. Mm-hmm. People aren't happy about it that have that type of software.
You gotta protect yourself.
And then moving on to Breeze, the project's been delayed. They were anticipating that the contract would have been signed last week. There's been another delay. I'm not quite sure what's going on with it, but they're hoping that it'll be signed and have a contract in place by October 1st. I know one of the things that may be kind of stalling it is that the vendor that we'll be working with was working with CalPERS. So I don't know if that had much to do with it, but they are looking at the contract, and hopefully they'll get it through, because this is something that Consumer Affairs could really benefit from. And our staff has put in a lot of hard work. We've got Jason over there, I would almost say probably half time. I bet he's putting in 40 hours there. He's working hard on it. And then we also have to have two subject matter experts from licensing and enforcement that will almost be full-time dedicated to that project as well. And then our email system that's going to be moving, transitioning to the state shared email system based on the executive order. We've been working on that. We're one of two boards that are the pilot program, along with medical board, and it's scheduled to be in place by October, November. And once that's completed, then the rest of DCA will move. Again, there have been glitches with it, and so our IT shop has been working with them to move it forward. And if they can't resolve those glitches, we may just pull out of it. But at this point, we're working hard to get it in place. The next couple of pages, this is our annual statistical profile report. And if you want to pull these pages out just for your reference throughout the year, but every year our board and all of the boards at Consumer Affairs and the bureaus put together a program summary, and it goes through licensing data, the pass-fail rates of examinations, goes through enforcement, investigations, how many days it takes to complete an AG case, and there's just a lot of good information here that you might want to just keep in case you're ever questioned on it.
Can I ask a question on this page, mm-hmm. this program summary?
I thank you very much for providing it to us. I think it's really great information. But I was just sitting here and thinking of the students that are here from Mount SAC, and I don't know if they're still here. But, you know, I was looking at the exam results,
mm-hmm.
and it might be disheartening to them to see that, you know, most of these persons that fail the exams, well, the majority of the exams, approximately 50% or more, fail them. And I don't know if we keep any records or track information to see why that's happening, or why that is a case where, you know, the majority of these exams, you know, over 50% of the people fail them.
That's about average for a licensing board. I can tell you from the board I came from, which was the engineering board, their pass rates were a lot lower. At times, we'd even see like a 2 to 10% pass rate. So it's about an average pass rate for the consumer affair boards, around 50%.
Because you want to be a contractor doesn't mean you...
Yeah.
Right. Test.
We're planning on having a... Next time we meet in Sacramento, we'll have Heidi Linser Hill explain the entire exam development and administration process. Basically, an exam doesn't stand alone. The qualifications for the exam. California has historically erred on the giving candidates the opportunity to fail, if you will, allowing them to take the exam. Other states, I know, have much higher standard before you can even take the exam, and they might have a higher exam pass rate. So you can't ever look at it in a vacuum. And when Heidi explains how exams have to meet federal and state legal requirements, it'll give you a much better comfort level about how the exam process works.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions?
I just had one little quick question on the payment system. I think we had like a 2014.
On the e-payment system, I believe it was like a 2014, you know, up and running date. Is that still good, or do we?
Well, that may be it got combined in with Breeze. So we were told to kind of stop what we were doing, and then with our staffing also, we've had to allocate resources to Breeze and now this new web server thing. So it's just a resource, and then Breeze, so we could do it.
But it doesn't look like it's going to happen at that date then.
Probably not.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Hearing none, we'll move on to the budget briefing on your packet. It's I-2. Cindy?
On the first page, you're going to see the fiscal year 2010-2011. It's a summary of everything, all of our expenses and revenue through the end of June 30th, 2011. No surprises. We spent about 96% of our final budget, and we'll be reverting about 3.7%, which is a little over $2 million. That'll go back into our fund. And then as far as our revenue, the change from the prior year was about 1%. Moving on to page 2, the first table that you'll see on the top of the page is for the 2011-2012 budget, that's this year, that was included in the 2011 budget bill. And there were various things included in there that would be adjustments for the employee compensation and retired cost adjustment, that's the second column, the workforce cap adjustment, and that is we were required to do some cost savings by eliminating 5% of our overall workforce, and what we were able to do was adjust some of that on our personnel line item and also operating and expenses. So that's what the third column is, and then the healthcare cost adjustment and the miscellaneous adjustment. So we had a budget of $59.5 million that was from the budget bill. But then we had additional adjustments, as you can see on the bottom of that page, for Breeze. We had an additional 5% cost savings adjustment, which really isn't 5% if you look at it, it was $305,000. Not going to ask why, how they did the math. It benefited us, so that's a good thing. And then our cell phone reduction. So our final budget is $59,200,000 for this year. Our fund condition is on page 3. This is through 2013-2014. You'll see as we get out through 2012 and 2013, you're going to see adjustments for Breeze, the subsequent arrest budget change proposal, and the Breeze credit card. So those things are still going through, and that does affect our fund condition. As you can see, in 2013-2014, we'll have about 2.5 months in reserve. And the budget change proposal that we're moving forward for this year is for our subsequent arrest program. And 2012, 2013, we're asking for $398,000, and then an ongoing amount of $392,000. And on page four, the construction management education account, licensees have the opportunity on their renewal notices to basically give some money to this account in any amount. I think, I don't know if it was $5 or whatever amount they want. And so we have this account, and then any accredited education system, such as Cal Poly or Chico or Sacramento State, they can submit a request to us to say, you know, we've got this program based on the number of students, and that's how the money is divided throughout the state. So this is the final budget remaining. We had $165,000 for this year. We gave out $132,000, so we had $33,000 remaining, and we have 20% left. And then the fund condition is shown here. It's projected in 2013 and 2014 that we most likely will not have anything remaining at the current rate that we're getting funds. Any questions?
Well, if we won't have any remaining, what's the, do we have to come up with something during our strategic plan for the CMEA?
Well, historically, we've had some years where we didn't give grants. Basically, when we have enough money in the fund to give grants, then we issue them.
Okay.
Are there any other questions? Hearing no other questions, we'll move on to agenda item I3, review and approval of budget change proposal concept regarding the subsequent arrest program, and Cindy will also give that report.
Each year we go through and we put together concept papers and then a final budget change proposal. And the budget change proposal itself is quite extensive. It has a lot of justification, a lot of backup, like worksheets that go along with it, that is confidential. But what we are asking for today is your approval and perhaps a motion that would give us the authority to move forward with this budget change proposal concept, where we're requesting additional resources. We'd like five positions. Four of them will be enforcement representative ones and one office tech position for our enforcement division to establish a subsequent arrest and conviction notification unit. And we really don't have the full staff right now to go through all of the arrests and conviction notices that we get. Basically, what they do is they look at the higher degree offenders, and then some of the others just skate through. So we'd these number of the notifications have grown a lot, but just because of our resources, we're not able to get to them. So unless there's any questions, I'd like to get a motion to approve this budget change proposal concept today.
Second. There's a motion and a second. Is there a question? Any questions?
Well, I think it's important to note that, as she said, we've fingerprinted them for years now, and now they've subsequently, some of them experience problems, get arrested, and how are we to know unless we've got somebody that's tracking it? Mm-hmm. I think it's an important thing, and certainly, I don't know what our chances are, but we've got 0% chance of getting it if we don't ask for it. So I think it's a good effort.
Absolutely. Any other questions or comments? Hearing none, we'll go to vote. All those in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, move on to agenda item I4, the update of the 2011-2012 strategic plan objectives, and our registrar, Steve Stans, will provide this update. Steve?
Okay, basically, a lot of these are being delayed because of the hiring freeze and budget considerations. I'll go through these very quickly. Number one, the reorganization of the enforcement division Cindy talked about. That's basically the CPS contract, which we had hoped to get started last spring. Now it looks like it's going to start in October. The media outreach plan is pretty much on track. Rick's all over that. We have begun developing a plan to explore licensure. We're not going to have a solution to this for maybe years, but we need to set up a plan by the end of the year for how we're going to deal with it. The new flagship consumer publication might move back a quarter, but we're going ahead on that. Training curriculum. Those of you who went to Norwalk and talked to the staff, you know that we are moving along pretty aggressively in a new training program, so that's pretty much on track. Number six, we talked about that in detail at the enforcement committee meeting. David has initiated this. Pretty close to on track on that. Seven, we could, the target date has changed to three big question marks because of Breeze. Legislator relationship plan eight, we'll talk about that at the next legislative committee meeting. Nine, that this is a bill that should be signed by the governor fairly soon. This is going to be a resource issue regarding when we can actually implement that law, because it takes IT resources and they're spread so thin, there's no guarantee when we will get to that. Again, with 10, Rick's on track for the starting the new education publication. We're going to move the 11 back at least a quarter to the second quarter. Number 12, we are progressing on that. We have all these different MOUs that we're reviewing with different state agencies. 13, again, this is a goal, but it just depends on who's available and when we can schedule background checks, and if people leave after they get their background check and go to other organizations, which is happening. So that's just kind of, so we are moving forward on it, and it'll be almost like a continuous process. 14 is our subsequent arrest BCP we talked about. Just so you know, if you ever have a BCP, you need to have that in your strategic plan. So anytime we anticipate a BCP, it will be an objective in a strategic plan. 15 deals with the CPS contract, like I mentioned earlier. And 16 is, again, three big question marks because of IT resources and Breeze. So what we plan on doing is keeping this chart in each board packet and updating you on each one as they go along. Are there any questions? Thank you.
Well, hearing no questions, we'll move on to agenda item J, the review of the tentative schedule, and Registrar Chief Stans will give that report as well.
Okay, working backwards, if you look down June 5th, our June board meeting, it will be in the Newport Beach area. We will meet with the Nevada board again. We'll figure out a location. Well, how was the last location? Should we just try the same hotel?
Sounds good. Right there?
Work? All right.
Sounds good.
For the April board meeting, that's our strategic planning session. We have a tradition of going to Monterey, even though it is difficult to get to. Do you want us to try that again? Any objections to that? All right. Okay, now February and December, one should be in Sacramento, and we haven't met in the Bay Area. Are there any other areas of the state? They really don't like us to go to Palm Springs or San Diego or but Bay Area, one should be in the Bay Area, one should be in Sacramento. Do you have a preference for which in the time? They are pretty close together, just 2 months apart. Okay. Well, how about if December we shoot for Sacramento? At that meeting, we'll talk about legislative proposals. We may have a budget update for you. And then February, we'll shoot for somewhere in the Bay Area. Maybe some of our Bay Area board members can give us some ideas of locations we might want to look at. So, any objections? Sacramento at the board December 6th, and we'll figure out a location for February 7th.
Which one of those is NASCLA attend?
Not NASCLA, it's the Nevada
board.
June.
Yes. Any other questions on schedule? Hearing no other questions, we'll move to agenda item K, adjournment. I'm open for a motion to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Stand adjourned.